very warm welcome to all to this session of Lawyers Club India LCI Talk. I'm Arunabh Rajan, and today we have amongst us Mr. Vaibhav Kalra, founder and pullman of Kalra & Company. Sir has been in the profession of advocacy for more than 10 years now, and has a vast multi-jurisdictional experience, such as in labor law, family law, and other areas of law. Now, before moving on to the topic, I would like to give you a brief introduction of Lawyers Club India. LCI is a knowledge sharing platform with more than 625,000 registered users, including legal professionals, law students, and other people. We have 125,000 registered legal experts to solve the queries posed by our users and to provide them with effective resolution. We all know that during this unfortunate time of COVID-19, approaching lawyers have become a difficult task. And therefore, we have started this new initiative of quick resolution sessions to provide easy, elaborate, and accurate resolution to the queries. Now, I would like to request Mr. Kalra to give a brief introduction of himself.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I hope everybody is staying safe and inside their houses. My name is Vaibhav Kalra, and I'm a managing partner and the founder of my firm, Kalra & Company. I've been practicing in Delhi for over a decade now, and I think it's best time now to give it back to the profession, and I'm here to solve all your queries the best I can.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, so our first query is related to eviction. Wherein the querist has rented one part of his house to a tenant for 11 months, according to an agreement they have entered into. Now, the query states that the tenant has refused to pay rent for past 3 months. The tenant has said that he will not pay rent henceforth, and also as he refused to vacate the house. So, what recourse would the querist seek here?
See, a tenancy is governed usually by the agreement between the parties. Now, the essential conditions of staying at a place or lease or rent is the fact that you have to pay the rent. Under the Transfer of Property Act, Section 108 suggests that in order for a tenant to have a right to stay in the property, you must pay the rent. Now, failure to pay the rent is a ground for eviction. So my suggestion is that at the very first instance, what you can do is send him a legal notice saying that you have not paid rent for last 3 months, claim the arrears of the rent with an immediate effect of terminating the lease and pointing it out to the tenant that because you have not paid the rent for 3 months, therefore you are asked to please vacate the premises. However, if the tenant refuses to even then vacate the premises, the only option that you have is for a suit for eviction, which will depend upon the jurisdiction in the court in which you are. And you can file in suit saying that please evict the person along with the arrears of the rent and the interest, if any, thereupon. So the first step is that you can send in a notice seeking the arrears of the rent and asking them to vacate immediately. And usually, these lease agreements always have a termination clause. So while invoking the termination clause, you can always say that please vacate the premises. So that would be the advice that I'll give you.
So how much time would it take to initiate the proceeding and finally adjudicate the same? And what would be the cost involved in that?
Okay, now see, there are various aspects of it. The first would be that you send them a notice immediately giving them, let's say, a 15-day time to clear the areas and to vacate the premises. Now, essentially, you'll have to wait for that 15-day period. Thereafter, you can immediately approach a lawyer and you can file a suit before the court. Now, usually, it depends upon how much is your rent, because then you'll have to pay the court fees also. So, under the Court Fees Act, usually, when you are seeking eviction, then you'll have to assess the court fees in terms of the rent of the premises. And usually the courts are very quick, because the things that you have to prove in such cases, the basic three pillars are very simple: that I am the landlord, And if the tenant accepts that he's the tenant and I am the landlord, agrees that there was a lease agreement entered between the parties, then the scope of these judicial proceedings is very narrow. See, the idea is that you are not asked to prove whether you have the right over the property or not. Once the tenant accepts that I am the landlord, then it's a very quicker process. Because the moment you will file a suit, he'll file his written statement and he'll essentially have to answer these three questions. Whether I am the landlord, whether he's the tenant, if he admits to the tenancy and the agreement, and the fact that he's paying all of those. So what you all also need in all of these situations is that you need proof that the person is paying me rent. There will be email exchanges. The rent would be paid through checks or through online transfers. So once you point out all of these questions, I think it will take at least 6 months to a year maximum. But it's a very summary procedure. If he's admitting all of these three points and you have the requisite proof.
Indeed, sir. So we have now a second question. Now here the querist has 5 siblings. His parents passed away 20 years back, leaving post office deposit and shares in various companies. Now, one of his siblings, A, had unanimously applied for succession certificate to be issued to him, which was contested by other siblings. Finally, all the siblings agreed that the succession certificate be awarded to sibling B, which was done in 2017. Now, sibling B, post the issue of succession certificate, shared only the money out of post office savings and bank account, which is not cooperating on sharing the proceeds out of stocks held in various companies. Now, in this, the querist wants some legal remedy against the sibling who is trying to take away all the money.
All right. See, usually, now there are certain things that we need to know better. But I'm assuming that all of these siblings had contested the proceedings in the successions to get the succession certificate. Now, if they were against it, whether they entered into a settlement or an agreement where they all agreed to give up their right and then say that B should have the succession certificate in their favor or not, a lot of things will depend on that. Now, succession certificate is essentially a person who is the custodian or let's say a trustee that I will get the things in my name. And I'm assuming that there was an agreement between the siblings that once I'll get this proceedings, I will separate it and I will distribute between all other siblings. And based on the query, he did at least part of it, but he's not complying with the full terms of the settlement. Now, under these circumstances, the remedy that you have is either to approach the court under Section 383 of the Succession Act and say that we had agreed upon a term where he had to distribute it, but he's unable to do it. Therefore, the succession certificate should be cancelled. Or that this succession certificate or the fact that I agreed to let B have the proceeds or the so-called properties or the shares and the money on the basis that he will then distribute it amongst us. And that essentially that agreement itself is not being honored by B. Therefore, please cancel it because it's been obtained by way of a fraud. See, the problem here is that when you agree to such terms, the scope becomes very limited. And if the party is complying with part of it and not, then it becomes even more difficult. But usually when you approach courts and you say that the difficult part was to prove the agreement or the settlement between the parties, but where you have complied with half of it, then it becomes very easier to then approach the court and say, see, here's the situation. We had agreed upon. We had withdrawn our protest against it. We were not contesting it based on the fact that he'll distribute amongst ourselves all of these things. Unless you are able to show that agreement or the distribution, the scope is very limited once you give somebody, a no objection to that. I think I'm not going to object to the succession. Now, usually, this is a cumbersome process. You'll have all the siblings have to unanimously be there. Everybody will have to come and say, we'll have to explain that how, when, what was the point. We'll have to prove that these were the things. How did we distribute? Why is he not distributing? A notice has been sent, has to be sent to the person. So this requires some time. I mean, I'll be very honest with these people. And that's what we usually do. When a client approaches us, the first thing that we tell them is, let's see, the win percentage, the time that you will invest, the money that you will invest. So a lot of factors depend upon that. And suppose, let's say, since the essentials of the quantum is missing here, assuming the quantum is, let's say, 30,000 rupees. Now, there are between five siblings, four are not getting. So at best, you will get 5,000 to 6,000 rupees per person. Now, in such a situation, I advise my clients that instead of spending more money on the litigation, it's just 30,000. If the amount is huge, substantial, depending on those facts and circumstances, then we advise the client, because all these processes at the end of the day, you see, if I have to approach to a court, now there's lawyer's fee, there's court fee, there's proceeding fees, a lot of host of factors have to be looked into. But if the amount is substantial and if he's paid half, he's not refusing to pay the other, the remedy that you have is then to collectively, as all siblings should come and approach the court and say, this has been obtained on the basis of an understanding which was not ordered. So therefore, the scope here is slightly limited, but it can be done, depending on the amount per se.
We have this third question from Janakuri. So one of the queries states that his father, who resides in Janakpur itself, signed a compromise in court with his landlord on 2nd March to vacate his rented premises on 2nd May 2020. But because of the lockdown, he could not go out for search of the new house. Now, there are three parts of this particular query. Firstly, can the landlord vacate the premises forcibly on 4th May when curfew opens? Secondly, can he get another 2 months extension from court on the basis of curfew? And thirdly, any other option available to them?
Hola. Now see, this is a very situation specific query. Now, not only the person who's asked the question, a lot of people today are facing this difficulty. Now, the essential things that we have to keep in mind here are few. Now, you enter into an agreement, and at the time of entering into the agreement, both parties could not foresee the fact that there'll be such a spread of a virus or the government will lock down the whole area. So what was the essential conditions or the primary factors while entering into the settlement was that the tenant will be granted 2 months' time to vacate the premises. And after 2 months, he will hand over the possession. Now, in between those 2 months, a situation has arisen which was neither foreseeable or seen by any of the parties. Now, in such a situation, a lot of people will face such a problem. But the remedy that you have is to first, at the first instance, you have to then write a letter to the landlord saying that these are the circumstances. It was entered on a date with a clear understanding that I'll get 2 months' time to vacate the premises. And immediately thereafter, these are the steps that I took. However, from 15th of March, by virtue of the notifications, the lockdown has come into the force, and because of which I was not able to find out an alternative accommodation for myself. Therefore, as and when the lockdown gets lifted, because we don't know whether it's going to be there on the 4th or not. So the query number one is dependent on the fact that when the lockdown is open. So as soon as it's open, I would require at least 2 more months or 1.5 months, because 15 days time he already had, to vacate the premises. Now, usually the landlord may agree, may not agree to this proposition, but the essential condition and the requirement that you have to keep in mind is that during that period, you have to pay the rent. It can't be that I'll not pay the rent beyond those 2 months. So one is that you will have to continue paying the rent. So your letter or the notice should specify that I am willing to pay the rent on the existing amount. And if the landlord then does not agree, then the only remedy that you have is to approach the court where you had settled the matter. File an application, an urgent application saying, these are the conditions that I'm going through. These are the circumstances and situations. I've been forced to be evicted from my premises. And because of the prevailing circumstances, there's a lockdown, I can't even step out of the house. The question of finding an alternative place and then moving in and shifting, we need the logistics. Nothing is available in the market right now. So therefore, I've been forced to be evicted from this premises, and I'm willing to pay the rent. And you would also remember, see, the Supreme Court has now issued a order which extends all sorts of limitations as if nothing is moving beyond 15th of March. So you can use that. File an application before the court and say, please extend my time period for compliance of this compromise deed. I am ready to abide by the terms, but I would need certain more time from the date on which the lockdown is lifted. And there are regular notifications which are issued in Delhi where the courts have said that urgent listing of matters will be heard by the district courts, or depending on the property and the price of the property and the rent. I'm assuming it will be in the district court, but if the rent is too much, then the high court. They are listening to urgent matters. So this will perhaps fall under the category of urgent listing. And you can then immediately file an application. So it's a simple process. You just file an application before the court, send them a notice, file an application, attach those documents, say that you're willing to pay the rent, and with a request that it should be extended, and hopefully it will be. We are all empathetic towards the situation, and these are all difficulties that we are going to face. Imagine a condition if somebody can't even move out of the house or hire people for moving and transportation. So I think the landlord will also look into it, because, see, at the end of the day, the landlord will not be able to evict the tenant and then find someone else. So even he's getting the rent every month. Practically, I think it's best for both the people to agree and then move on. So that will be, I think, the best course of action in the present circumstances.
So next question we have regarding agreement on the piece of land. So the querist has an agreement that the subject matter of which is a piece of land. The seller of this land got involved in some legal issue and the matter is now in the court. Now the question is the agreement between him and the seller affected, or should he file a separate suit in the court?
Now see, there are two, three different things in this present question that we need to consider first before we, look about and go about this problem. Now, there is a purchaser and there is a seller. Now, I'm assuming, or rather I should ask you, because the query is online, so therefore we don't have the benefit of the person asking the question, and there are a host of factors. So I will try to answer it in a different format and try and cover up all the different scenarios. Now, the first scenario will be where the seller and the dispute in which the seller is involved could be any other dispute, not necessarily on the subject matter of the agreement between the purchaser and the seller. Now, in that circumstances, if somebody is in some form of litigation and he is a seller, the land in this, the question here between the parties is not under any dispute, is not mortgaged, is not challenged, his right is not affected, then you need not do anything. And there is nothing that you're supposed to do in approach to court. Now, let's take for an example where the seller is in a litigation, qua the land itself, which is a subject matter of an agreement between the purchaser and the seller. Now, there is a difficult situation. They'll again depend on whether the property is mortgaged, then you will have recourse differently, or whether his right to sell or his ownership itself is under challenge. Now, if its ownership itself is under challenge, and if you are aware of such a proceeding, then all you have to do is wait and hold your hand till the time you get to know whether it's there or not there. So there are different circumstances under which we'll have to look at this particular query. Now, let's say, for example, there are times where the seller has sold off or entered into an agreement to sell with you, the purchaser, and he's also entered into an agreement to sell with some third party. Now, in such a circumstance, what you can do is you can approach the court and say, there is an agreement to sell. I have paid him the consideration amount, and now he's trying to sort of sell it, the same property, to someone else. So there, your proceedings and the way you initiate the proceedings, the time frame, the remedies, these all keep changing depending on the situation in which the property is. Usually, if the property or the concept in or the land in dispute, if it's not related, there is no question on the title, then you need not approach the court at all. However, if there is such a situation, then the remedies will depend on the facts. So you were telling me, I think what you were trying to say was that if such a situation is arising, the last part of the question, can you just tell me again?
Yeah, so should he file a separate suit in the court?
No, then there is no need to...
Yeah, so then there is no need. The last part of the question was, should he file a separate suit in the
court? So therefore, there is no need of filing a separate suit if the question or the subject matter of the litigation of the seller is has nothing to do with the property. Then you need not. However, it is if it is necessary there and you are a purchaser and you have paid the consideration amount, then it depends on the nature of the suit. Then you can either file an impleatment application. You need not file a separate suit at all. You can be party to the litigation and say, I am the purchaser or I am the bona fide purchaser. I have paid the consideration amount. And then the court will look into it. Because see, the idea here is, which the courts have repeatedly said, is to avoid multiplicity of litigation. So you can't have, let's say, 2-3 different suits running on the same property. If you're aware of such a thing, you might as well file an impleatment in the pending matter and say that I am the purchaser of the property. I have paid the consideration. I am the owner. So my advice will be that sometimes you'll have to look at the various factors which are involved. Based on that, these kind of matters tend to take some more time to resolve. So that would be my advice to the querist.
Thank you, sir. So next question we have it regarding partition. So the querist states that his father, who is a Hindu, passed away in year 1982, leaving behind 7 children, out of which 3 are sons and 4 are daughters. The property has still not been partitioned between the children. His question is whether the daughters are entitled to share in the property.
Right. Now see, these situations or where the right of the daughter is there in the property of the father or not. See, you will have to look at, I'll just explain a little bit of law and the concept which the person must understand. See, when you get such cases, we have to then tell the clients also that, see, you have, these are your rights. This is the law which was prevailing earlier, and this is the law which changed. So essentially, what governs is the Hindu Succession Act. Now, this act was amended on, I believe, on 9th of September 2005, where for the first time, the right was granted to the daughters. That came for the first time. The daughter will also have the right that I am the owner, right in the father's property. Now, obviously a question came up and arose before the court that what about when the death of the father has happened prior to the date? Is this amendment retrospective or this amendment is prospective? So the Supreme Court then came into the question arose before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court then clarified that if the death of the father is after the date of the amendment, that is September 2005, then the daughters will also have a right in the property. However, if the death has happened prior to it, then the daughters will not have any right in the property because it's not a right which is acquired by birth, because the right itself was recognized after the amendment came into the picture. I think there was a 2016 judgment of the Supreme Court which clarified it. So, yeah, to answer the query, because the death has happened, I think, in 1982. Yeah, in 1982, then they will not have the right to claim anything in the property.
Thank you, sir. I think this is the most clear-cut answer that. So a follow-up question would on this topic would include the right of a daughter who is still in the womb of the mother. what would happen if she's not born yet? Like, as you said, the cutoff date of 9 September 2005. What if she is in the womb at that point of time and born is born after that?
So see, like I said, and I'll just clarify that statement again, the right will accrue to the daughter once the death of the father is after September 2005. If he's died before 2005 and as on that date on which the death occurred, there was no daughter. If there is no daughter alive, there is no right. And even if she was alive, she has no right, because that right is only recognized from the date. Or that's what the Honorable Supreme Court, if I remember correctly, the Supreme Court then clarified that the death should happen or should occur after this date, not prior to this date. Now, there is an interesting set of questions and propositions that do arise, that what if the partition hasn't happened? Now, partition is happening after the death. And is this, if this the right, suppose somebody is alive and the death happens post September 2000, and the partition is not happening. So there is a slight area which the courts are considering. But the general view is that if the death has happened afterwards, then the girl obviously has the right. However, if it happens prior, then she has no right.
Thank you, sir. Sir, so the next question we have is that the querist works as a supplier of various wholesale items to the small retailer shop. One such retailer has an overdue and paid through check, which was returned by the bank with a note of insufficient funds. He asked the retailer and he promised to solve the problem, but no positive steps have been taken by the retailer. What is the remedy in this case?
Okay, now this is a very classic commercial dispute that we always face, where the sellers are selling and providing the goods and delivering the goods and services, and they're not being paid, and there is a check issued and a promise to make good the payment or the consideration for this. Now, essentially, you have two solutions or the remedies as available in law for such a situation. One will be if you invoke the provision, special provision of the Negotiable Instruments Act, wherein you say that the check was delivered and given and bounced. And the other is to file a civil suit. Now, let me explain the difference between the two and in which circumstances and which case can you come approach under the Negotiable Instruments Act or under the, let's say, the ordinary civil suit or the civil remedy. Now, see, the difference is if you want to invoke on the provisions of the Negotiable Instruments Act, then you'll have to essentially keep a few things in mind. And I'll just explain to you what those things are. Now, again, the query does not have the date on which they got to know about the insufficient funds. Did they send a legal notice? When did they send a legal notice? What is the response? So I'll just give you a brief background as to how do we initiate such proceedings under the Negotiable Instruments Act, and for which a lot of your users can open up Section 138 of the Act, and which it describes the limitation period for all of this. So I'll just explain for the users that you have. Now, first step is criteria is that the check should be presented within the period in which it's valid, which is usually 3 months from the date of issue of the check. Now, having presented it on time, from the date on which it is returned with a note insufficient funds, within 30 days from that date, you have to send a legal notice saying that I had made such a supply. In consideration thereof, you had issued me a check, and based on your instructions, I presented the check. The check is returned with a query or with a note that there are insufficient funds. Therefore, I call upon you to please pay back the money within the period of 15 days, failing which I'll initiate proceedings under the Negotiable Instruments Act for check bouncing. Now, immediately on the expiry of that 15-day period in which you asked the person to pay, thereafter, you can file an application, or you can file a petition before the trial courts or before the court of appropriate jurisdiction, depending upon the amount of the check, and say that I am enumerating the whole transaction, that this is the amount, this was a transaction, this is where I paid, and he has refused to pay. However, let's suppose there's a situation where the limitation period, as I just explained to you, is expired, and there might be situations where parties are interacting with each other and there is a promise to pay and then failure to pay and uphold that promise. Now, what do you do in such situations? Now, the second remedy that you have is that then you can again send them a legal notice first and say that this was the transaction, this is the money, the goods that were supplied to you, these are the challans, this is the date on which it was supplied, and then you had agreed to pay and you did pay, and in lieu of the consideration amount, you've given me a check, the check was bouncing, therefore I'm calling upon you, make the payment. If till then there is no payment made, then the remedy that you have is then under the CPC. You can then file a suit before the courts of appropriate jurisdiction and from the whose territory you are, and you can say that these are suits which are called as summary suits under Order 37. Now, this is again a summary trial. Even under the Negotiable Instruments Act, it's a summary trial, and even under this, it's a summary trial. So you file a suit, a summary suit, and say, this was the bills of exchange, this is the transaction, this is the agreement, this is where I've made the payment, supplied the goods, and I've received the payment. Therefore, the courts are much quicker in resolving this, because if you file a summary suit and the court is satisfied that there are no tribal issues, it's a straight cut situation where you have supplied the goods and you have received the goods. Then the conditions prescribed therein are that you have to first enter the, then the notices are issued, and from the date on which the notice is issued and is received by the respondent, you have to enter the court within 10 days. You have to enter your appearance, file your appearance within 10 days, and then you're given 30 days time to file your leave to defend. If the court, in after looking into your leave to defend, is not satisfied that there is no tribal issue, then you straight away get your money. So that's a much quicker process. Now, what has also happened today, now with the coming of the Commercial Courts Act, now it can also be termed as a commercial suit. Now, even under the Commercial Courts Act, there are certain transactions which are defined as commercial transactions, which essentially have to be then filed under the Commercial Disputes Act. Now, once you go under the Commercial Dispute Act, again, everything is a time-bound matter. And the very interesting thing that the commercial courts have now introduced is whenever you file such a case, the first step is that you must mandatorily go for mediation. And a lot of dispute is then resolved through the process of mediation. That's much more time-consuming, cost-effective, where parties are sitting across the table in front of a mediator and they're resolving the disputes. See, because in a lot of such transactions, you will also face a query that people will not like to disrupt their relationship, work relationships. So what that gives us an opportunity to resolve it without going to the court in an amicable manner. Suppose you owe me 1 lakh rupees and I will. The difficulty is that when you file a suit, it will take its own time, be it 1 month, 2 months, depending on the nature of the suit, or a year. But you'll have to wait for that money. However, if you invoke mediation and through the process of mediation, if you can resolve it, you'll get your money today. So therefore, depending on the circumstances and the situation and the limitation period, there are 3 different factors. Now, under the Commercial Courts Act, suppose the mediation doesn't work and you come back to the court. Even then, the directions are such that you have to then resolve it within a particular period. So all your dates or the trials are fixed. So that's again a very quick way of resolving the dispute. Obviously, it will take some time and money depending on the lawyer, depending upon the amount. So it is a time consuming process, but at the end of the day, you will have to, there are various host of factors. How much is the amount? Then what is the who's the lawyer, how much is he charging? So all of these factors you'll have to keep in mind while resolving such a dispute. But if you have the correct documents, if you have the proof of deliveries and acceptance, very good case to file.
So I had a question regarding the procedure of the Negotiable Instrument Act. Suppose there might arise a situation where rather than filing after the expiry date of 15 days, someone files an application on, say, 13th day. Would the court will then wait for the 15th day and then take cognizance of the matter, or would it be dismissed?
No. See, the point is, you're asking me if you file the case on the 13th day, then essential conditions of, I think the essential conditions of that you have to give them the 15-day period. is not fulfilled. So therefore, the court will say that the 15-day period is not being. But usually, see what happens is, you're presuming that the person is not going to pay. A lot of parties then wait for at least that 15-day period. And when you approach the lawyer, the first thing that he will say also, that the period of 15 days is still not over. So see, it depends on the lawyer also. If he's overzealous and he's like, no, I'll file it. Usually when such a client comes to us, we say, please, you have to first wait the mandatory period of the limitation and then only we can file the suit before the appropriate forum. Usually that will not be a case, but if it is, it will be very interesting to see. But my advice is that it will not work. You'll have to at least wait for that 15-day period.
Next question is that the querist's father purchased a land from his uncle, his father's eldest brother, some 45 years ago. They did not know about this until recently when he found the original sale deed. But the said property is under the possession of the children of the uncle and they are not willing to return the property. What is the remedy here, sir?
Now see, again, these are all cases which will depend on the facts as to when did you get to know about this. Now, what we do have in front of us is a sale deed which was executed between the uncle of the querist and the father of the querist. Now, this was a 45-year-old sale deed. Now, I'm assuming both of them have expired. And under what circumstances it has now come surfaced with the plaintiff, the supposed plaintiff. And if the querist has now found the fact that I have now come across this sale deed and the other side is already staying in the house, whether they are aware of such a transaction or not, if they were aware of such a transaction and they were still, they are still staying in the property. So the query will change on that. Suppose you were aware of it and you did not initiate anything, then the concept of adverse possession will come into play. And I'll just explain what adverse possession is, that if knowing that I am not the owner of the property, suppose you are the owner of the property, you know the fact, you're aware of the fact that I am staying and occupying your property and it's been 13 years and you have not raised any sort of objection, litigation, complaint or police complaint also. And you're letting me enjoy the possession of the property more than 13 years. Then I develop right over the property. That's right through adverse possession. Now what happens in these situations like this is, essential conditions are that I must be aware that I'm the owner. So it's a very peculiar thing here that today if he becomes aware, suppose I didn't even know that I have the right over the property, like in their present way, and he gets to know about it today, then what he can do is then send them a notice saying that I'm the owner of the property, please vacate the premises. Now once they do this, it is a dispute or a question which is put to the person who's residing in the property. And interestingly, I'll share a very interesting dispute which arose. Now, can a party come to the court and say, at one hand, say, I am the owner of the property by virtue of the land or the property belonging to my father, the uncle's side. And two, that I am in the owner because of the adverse possession. Now, this controversy was settled by the Honorable Supreme Court recently. And they said that these are two inconsistent pleas. You can't take both simultaneously. You can't say I am the owner of the house because it belonged to my father and challenge the sale deed. At the same time, you cannot come to the court and say, be that as it may, without prejudice to that fact, I am also the owner of the property by virtue of adverse possession. Now, these two inconsistent pleas cannot be taken before the court. So you have to choose. Now, the burden shifts on the other side. They're coming back to the fact and saying whether the other side was aware of such a thing or not. Suppose you're aware, the uncle, that this property is sold off by my father. And you did not challenge that agreement by filing, a suit for declaration or cancellation of the sale deed that has been obtained by fraud. There was no consideration. It was only an understanding between the two. You never challenged. So therefore, you lose the right to challenge such an agreement then. Because see, the limitation there is also 3 years and it's a case which is a 45 years back. So a lot of things are there in it. Now, let's assume today you file that suit for possession and eviction. Now then a host of factors that you will have to look at, and if you're not in possession of the property, then the court fee is different. Whereas if you are in the possession of the property, then the factors change. What is the cost of the property? Then you'll have to pay either the court fees or the market value of the property. Or you'll have, if you are in possession, that you might don't have to pay the court fees on the market value. So a lot of things depend upon that. Where is the jurisdiction? Because I'm sure you'll ask me how much time will it take. These disputes take a lot of time because there are lots of mixed question of facts. You'll have to show to the court the knowledge wasn't there. If he died 45 years back, how is it that you came about the sale deed today? So these are a lot of factors which you have to then prove. So this is a lengthy litigation, and you will have to, the onus is on you first to first show that I wasn't aware of it. How did I come to know today? Otherwise, it's barred by limitation for you also. So these are a host of factors which are involved in this. So my advice to the person will be that he'll have to then disclose a little more particulars. Maybe he has approached the other side and the other side has said no. They were also not aware of it. So usually we take such matters, and I will again say that mediation is a very good process in which you can resolve these disputes amongst family. Could be a possibility here, but we need certain more information. Broadly, these could be the various remedies available to you. And therefore, I'm giving you a broader picture of what is the remedy that you can exercise and the difficulties. Like again, Arnav, I told you in the starting, we have to get this basic thing there. There are lawyers who want to do all the matters. You come to any lawyer and I'll say, yes, I'll do your matter. And then there are lawyers who say, please first understand that this is the merit of the matter. And today, if you do not have a merit on the matter, then I will advise my client not to go to court. You understand? See, there's one who's always willing to litigate. There's one who's telling the client at first instance that I don't think that you have a win percentage chance here, or you should or you shouldn't. Depends on the each individual, how they want to take it and how they don't want to take it. Therefore, the first step is to first explain to your client that these are the things that you have to face. This is the time factor. This is the money factor. This is the burden that you're going to do. Maybe half the clients will agree that I've not looked into the property for 45 years. Why do I want it now? So there are a lot of factors which depend here. My essential thing is that it also depends on the lawyer that you approach.
Well, thank you, sir, for covering all the probable aspects of the question.
Most welcome.
So now it's a theoretical question of can a vendor by an order of injunction be restrained from selling his property? In a suit for specific performance by the purchaser, will the time fixed for performance be extended?
As you rightly said, it's a very theoretical question. Now, let me answer it the best way I can, and let me first explain the concept of such suits for specific performance that you file. Now, so you have to first understand that it is governed, there is an agreement between a buyer and a seller. So when I purchase the property, usually you don't pay off in one installment. And there are various essential conditions, like today I'm at the time of signing, I'm paying this much amount, and then I'm going to pay in a month this much amount, or 2 months, depending on what is the term of the agreement. Now what happens is there are times where the purchaser is unable to pay the money. Then what should you do? You have paid the part payment, but the subsequent payment you have not paid. So, and interestingly, I'll also point out one of the essential factors is that when you enter into such agreements, you don't pay a hefty part at the start or at the signing of the agreement. You pay it in the subsequent manner. That's just the tendency of people. But then again, this will all depend on the facts of the case and how, what is happening is this. Suppose, let us take an example where there is an agreement. The purchaser is unable to pay and requires some more time to pay. Therefore, the seller now says that since you've not complied with the term and you've not paid within the time period as agreed upon between the parties, then I will now not sell the property to you. Then the remedy is that you approach the court in a suit for specific performance and say, now, what is the essential condition for a suit for specific performance is that I must have paid a substantial amount. Let's say it's a 1 crore property. I've already paid 60 lakhs, 70 lakhs, and it's just a 30 lakh amount which is left The second condition that you must satisfy is you'll be able to satisfy the court the reasons for not making that payment in that particular period. The third, which is more important, is the capacity of the person to be able to pay the remaining amount. Suppose there is an instance that I don't even have 30 lakh rupees. Then approaching a court and saying, oh, I can pay, but I don't have the money now. I'll get the money 10 months later. Court might issue notice, but eventually you will not win. So, and all these factors have depending on the evidence. But then there has to be in your plaint specifically that, yes, I do have the capacity to pay, but because of certain reasons, I could not pay within that 1 month period or the 2 month period or the agreed period between the parties. Now, when you file such a suit, usually it is accompanied by an application for stay or injunction that you cannot, in the meanwhile, the seller cannot sell off, alienate or dispose of the property. So as your query seems to suggest, there are three different conditions there also. Because you were asking me whether, what is the remedy? Can they file and seek injunctions? So stage one is, along with the suit, you file an application for injunction saying that the seller should be restrained from selling, alienating or parting with the possession of the property. Second situation will be where during the course of the suit, you come to know that the seller is trying to sell off the property to a third party. Immediately upon knowledge, you can come to the court. This is the third party. This is the seller. I believe that they are trying to sell off the property and seek injunctions. The third stage will be where you get to know that he's already sold off. Now, what do? Once the property is already sold off to the third party, then what you do is, what is the concept of a subsequent purchaser? Now, there are two different theories here. One is the doctrine of lis pendens, and the other is a subsequent purchaser and the right. The subsequent purchaser are also sometimes a bona fide purchaser who will not be even aware of that there is a previous transaction. The seller did not tell me that he has already sold off or entered into agreement of sale with the first party. Now, depending on these three different circumstances, now, what will be the right of the subsequent purchaser? So, as far as the querist is concerned, if he was the first purchaser, he can then implead the subsequent purchaser and say, make him a party, because his rights are getting affected. So if you do not make him a party, then your suit will fail. So you have to first implead that subsequent party. He will step into the shoes because he's somebody who might not be aware at all, because today he becomes the owner of the property. And then you continue with the suit. In such a circumstances, because since it's already sold off, then your injunction application will be, let him not part away the possession further to somebody. So that is the way. While what happens is, there's also one of very important factors is, suppose when the agreement of sale is entered in the year 2019. Today in 2020, I file a suit. It will take few years for it to be resolved because their evidences has to be opened. Suppose we are in 2025. Now, that time, you cannot say that the property was 1 crore, so I will pay 1 crore only. Because at that time, you'll have to then look at the market value of the property prevailing in 2025. Because it wasn't on my behest, the seller's behest, that the agreement couldn't go through. That burden of increase, proportional increase in the market price, will also have to be then borne by the purchaser. Now, does that mean that the money that I've paid goes? No. Then the subsequent relief that you have is that I want refund of that money that I've paid. At all, right? It can't be the seller can sell the same property to two different people or can keep the money also and say, I will not hand over the possession. So in that way, then you have to then seek the refund of the money. So under the specific relief act, you'll have to then also keep in mind that it cannot be only a suit for specific performance. It also has to have a relief attached to it, which is that, failing which, alternatively, I should get my money back. Because then you cannot take a plea that 3 years down the line, all right, if I failed in 2025, let me now seek refund of the money. That will become time barred, which is also a concept which we'll have to explain to the client that what is the relief that you seek from the court.
So in this regard, I had a question regarding the scope of injunction. So whether it can be enforced against the people who are implicated as parties, or it can be enforced against other persons as well. if they come into picture after a period of time.
Other people as in
those who are later affected by this particular injunction order, but not at that particular time. Do they have to be implicated as parties as well, or there is some other procedure by which it can be enforced against those persons as well?
So see, my understanding of your question is, suppose there's an injunction order against you per se, but despite that injunction order, you sell off the property, let's say, to a person B. Is that your question?
So suppose in this case, my father sells the property to some other person. Will he be restrained by that injunction order as well? Or is it only against me?
That's what I'm trying to ask. See, if there is an injunction order against you and you sell off the property to a third party, right? Then you will be liable for contempt. I can take actions against you for a civil suit, not called contempt per se, but these injunction orders are granted under Order 39. Now, if you look at Order 39 2A, once I have communicated to you that there is an injunction order and there is willful disobedience, and despite there being an injunction against you, you have still sold off. So I'll prosecute you under the Order 39 against you. All right. Then the other condition is, once I get to know that this property has been sold off to a third party, that's why I said the concept of bona fide purchaser, that person purchasing will not know that there is a litigation pending. And therefore, in such a circumstance, once you get to know, then you have to implicate that party and say and take an injunction against him that you cannot now sell off further. Which brings me back to the concept of what is the doctrine of lis, or what you call as doctrine of lis pendens. It's like when there is a dispute on a property and the dispute is pending before the court, then rights of the parties who are in court, who are that land, will survive. So if you keep selling it, you cannot take away that right that I am no more the owner, therefore this suit should be dismissed. That will not be.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, moving on to the next question. The querist has this particular query where in the present case, NHAI acquired the land and paid compensation to the owner. The plan which was proposed for the land now stands cancelled. So can the owner get back his land by paying back the compensation?
Now see, earlier there were all these issues were being raised. Suppose the compensation is not being paid. Compensation paid, but land not being used, which led to an amendment in the Act, under the Land Acquisition Act. Now, in terms of the amendment now, today, what will amount to a possession, how the possession is taken over, what is the compensation amount? But I'm assuming the query is that the land was taken over, the compensation was being paid, but the purpose for which it was maintained has not been utilized. So therefore, the new Act now, amended Act, says that you have to see whether the five-year period has expired or not. If the five-year period has expired, then, and still the property is not being used, then you can invoke the provisions of the Act and say, claim the property should be given back to me. At the same time, as an advice, you're taking back the property, you have to then give back the compensation amount. But there are lot of litigation on the aspect of when, suppose the purpose for which it was taken, that purpose itself is destroyed, then necessarily should we still wait for 5 years period or not? These are various questions which are still pending before the courts. Today, they will depend upon the various facts of the case. When was the property taken? What is the purpose? 5 year period has expired, not expired, and the host of other factors will have to be looked at.
Thank you, Vaibhav, sir. So again, we have this theoretical question of, can a partner from an unregistered partnership firm dissolve the firm and start a proprietary in the same name?
Now see, usually, there are two, three different concepts I'll just explain, since it's a theoretical question. Now, whenever there is a partnership between two people, there is always a partnership deed enumerating various situations and circumstances as to how do we divide the property and what is the partnership like. Suppose 50-50, 49-51, who will do what part one will perform, what part the other will perform. And usually these deeds also have a covenant in it as to how do we purchase the property or how do we look into the property. Suppose you enter into a partnership with your friend, right? Saying, I want to carry out a business of selling tins. Now, for that purpose, you say we are 50-50 owners. We both are going to, the partnership firm's name will be this. And then what you will hand over and give in 1 lakh rupees, the other person gives in 1 lakh rupees, and therefore we use that money to purchase the tins. Now, a situation that you're essentially asking is what happens when you want to dissolve the firm? So what happens is then you enter into a dissolution of firm agreement between the two parties where your assets have to be then looked into. Then various issues will come. Who will have the right to use the name? Maybe who will have the right of, there will be clauses of non-compete clauses can be there that you will not be able to then enter into a similar kind of a trade, or only I can enter into that kind of a trade. And then depending on that situation and the agreement between the parties, then you can either, if suppose it is between you and me and I get the right to use the name of the property. It's only under that circumstance that I can use the same trade name and then convert it into a sole proprietorship and then carry out the same kind of business. So it essentially depends on the terms of the partnership agreement and how two parties sit across and resolve these disputes. However, without there being a dissolution, if one of the partners starts using the name and opens up a similar kind of a business, then you can always go in a suit of injunction, permanent and mandatory injunction against the party, then you cannot use this because I am also owner of the trade name or the work. And then there are times where the assets are not distributed or the profit and loss statements are not taken care of. So therefore, then you essentially then file a case that I want to know the assets and the profit margins of various cases, that these are the things that you have not dissolved so far. Again, it will depend on what is the partnership deed, what is the work, what is the nature of the work, what are the covenants of the deed, and how do we then dissolve it. So yeah, it will require a lot of factors that you have to then pitch in together, and then only you can advise in a better way.
Thank you so much, sir. I'll certainly take it into consideration when I open my own firm.
Be very careful. Sole proprietorship is always the way to go.
So moving on to the next question. According to the queries, there are two brothers who are joint owners of a property. Now, one of the brothers want to give the other brother money as asked by him to leave the property. Is this possible in a joint ownership, firstly? And secondly, what is the remedy if the other brother continues to compel the person to leave?
Okay, now I think there are, again, three parts to the same question. I think the first part will be that if there are two joint owners of a property, can you buy the share of the other person? That will be the one. Two, can you compel a person to sell? And then the third part will be that if the other person is willing to sell, how do you go about the terms of it? Now see, the undisputed fact here is that there are two owners of the property. And there are cases where, suppose for whatever reason, they cannot stay together. Now, what you can usually do is then you enter into an agreement with the other side. I hope you do know that there is a process of pre-litigation mediation also available under the Delhi High Court. So you can invoke that, or you can sit across the table and have your own agreement between you and between the two co-owners and say that I want to buy your share of the property. You tell me what is the money that you need. I will pay off the fare, in lieu of which you will relinquish your right in the property. And that could also be one of the way a relinquishment deed is signed. There's no need of settlement. You enter into a relinquishment deed from the other side and say, I am relinquishing my right in your favor in lieu of this consideration. So the question whether it can happen, it cannot happen, it can happen, depends on the two people who are involved. Now let us take a second example where one person wants to buy the share, the other person is not willing to buy the share. They cannot be forced to sell off a share. They cannot be forced to sell off a share. If there is somebody who's troubling you in the usage of the property, then you can always file a suit for permanent and mandatory injunction that you cannot upsurge or obstruct my usage of the property because I have the right in the property. So a lot depends upon how the property is. Suppose it's a, if there are two floors. Usually the settlements are that I keep one floor, you keep the other floor. Like division of the property between the two people. So a lot of factors I have to look into. So to answer your queries, if you are willing to give up your share, take the appropriate money for it and move out, it's up to you. But you can't be forced or thrown out of the property because you are admittedly 50% owner of the property.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to the next question. We have a querist who gave a loan of 5 lakh rupees. And now when the time has come for repayment, the friend has stopped taking calls. When the querist sends some emails and the friend respondent saying he needs some time. Now the querist thinks of moving to the court. Is it the right move? Also, can the querist use emails as a form of evidence to show that there was exchange of loan?
Okay. Now, let me answer the second part of the question first and then I'll come back to the first. Now, first of all, emails can be used as evidences in court to prove a transaction, to show an admission by the other side about the money. And these are called electronic modes. So under Section 65B of the Evidence Act, there's a prescribed procedure and a format and a certificate, which you have to then attach along with an email. Now, I'll just give you a brief background about what are the essentials of a certificate under 65B. Now, it involves that this was the computer I used. This is the email ID I use. This email ID I use regularly as my email ID to converse, transact. And this is the primary email ID that I use. These emails were sent, received on this ID. Therefore, this is the printer on which I have taken the printout and then placed before the court. So to answer your query, yes, there is a provision to acknowledge electronic medias or data or emails or messages on the phone to prove a transaction that happened between the parties. Now, the next question that you asked me was, or the first question that you asked me was that what is the stage and what is the procedure? Now, what you can do is you can then first of all send them a legal notice saying that this is the money that I paid. You had promised me to give me back the money. This is the money that you owe me. Despite these emails that I have sent and your responses to those emails, wherein you acknowledge the debt, you acknowledge the loan, but you ask for more time, I am then seeking the money, recovery of that money. Give them a reasonable time of 15 days or 30 days, depending on whatever time you want. If you do not get anything back, and if he's not willing to make any further payment, then the only remedy is then you approach the court for a suit for recovery. Now, while recovering that money, you'll have to, again, the amount is 5 lakh rupees. So therefore, there is an appropriate court fee for 5 lakh rupees. Then you'll have to, then the other person will come. Usually these are, if she has to first admit or deny those emails, if he admits it, then you can get a decree on admission itself. If he doesn't, then you'll have to go through evidence. So it'll take some year or two to resolve such a dispute. But rest be assured, your money is safe once he's on emails admitted that he owed you some of money.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to the next question. The querist has a piece of land which was bought in 1977 in the name of a registered society. But in 2012, the then president and vice president of the society sold the land, claiming that they had paid the consideration for the land in 1977. And because of love and affection, they bought it in the name of the same society. Does this transfer of society's property void, and what remedy is there, if any?
Now see, whenever you open the society, it is governed by the Society's Registration Act. And essentially, once the property belongs to the society, you cannot sell it off being the office bearer of the property, of the society, sorry. Now, there are various restrictions under the Act, where the registrar of the society's permission is required, annual audits are required. For all those years, that property would have been shown as a property of the society and not of these individuals. Now, if they claim that they were the people who paid the consideration, did they disclose it in their records that I am the owner of the property and I'm transferring the property? So per se, when such an act is done, it's persuaded by fraud. And you can challenge it and you can say that this transaction or this sale is not without the right to sale. Now, in law, there's also a concept of that you cannot sell what is not yours. If you do not have the right or title to the property, then you cannot sell off that property. The right and the title belongs to the society. And if such a transaction does happen, then it's per se illegal transaction, and because you don't even have the right. Just being an office bearer of a society, you cannot sell off that. Then it also depends on the various memorandums of the society or the rules that govern the society. There are times where the president may be nominated as a person to take certain decisions regarding the properties of the society, that whether he has the right to represent the society in a sale transaction. That will depend again essentially on what are the terms, who is that person. But the query that you're raising today seems to be that a person is saying that even I purchased this property and I, out of my own love and care and affection, gave it in the name of the society, and today so I have the right to sell it off. That is not correct. That is not correct. The property belongs to the society. You cannot sell it off. I hope that satisfies the query.
Thank you, sir. So next question, we have it a region specific question. So the query is that how to get an urgent stay order when Bombay Municipal Corporation is forcefully trying to enter the private property of the querist and lay down sewage system line.
Now see, it's a problem that a lot of people are facing today. Now it's a classic question of the right of the individual vis-a-vis the right of the government or the municipality. For example, there is a proposition that my house and the land that belongs to me, I have the right and nobody can enter that property. And if they do, then it's called trespassing. But can the government enter your property? Can they take over your property? The answer to it is yes. They can acquire your property. They can take over your property. Now, the third part of this question is that today the sewage or the sewer lines is under the domain of the government. Now you'll understand and see. You must have seen in Delhi also, the situation keeps arising. They keep digging up these holes. So they, what they do is essentially, under the master plan and under the renovation plan, what they did was they wanted to improve or use this sewage lines because they wanted to control the sewage problem that was happening here. So what they do is, they lay down a center sewage line and they connect your individual sewage lines of your individual house to that main line. Now for that purpose, the query seems to be, does the government have the right to enter your house to help you have sanitation and to attach your sewage line to the main line to benefit you? The answer is yes. An individual right cannot take over the community's right. So, my advice to, see, this which brings me back to that initial thing that I was telling you, Arnav, that there are times where you have to tell your client that, you know what, there is a right in the government because that right is being exercised for your own benefit. If there is a proper sewage line and they are attaching that your sewage line to the main, this is for your own benefit. In such a circumstance, my advice to the client would be, don't go for such a litigation. Don't. Because they are here to help you solve a problem. That's besides the point. I am not saying that the government can barge into your house and start taking over the property. I am not saying that. They cannot take away a portion of your property and say, no, I am entering the place and I want to store my sewage pipes here. It's a separate thing. But an act which is for the greater good, that will prevail over individual rights of a particular person. So my advice is, don't go for any injunction and let the government do what they want to.
So in this regard, can this situation be equated to, say, a situation where government acquires a land for building a road or any infrastructure project? If so, would this be included as acquisition of property?
No. See, I'll just explain one of them. A government can't come to your house and say, I like your house, I want to acquire it. Acquisition doesn't work like that. There is a proper notification there's a proper plan, a setup. Let's, for example, a road. So there must be a proposition that I want to build a road, construct a road. And then for the purpose of the road, I will require a lot of place. For example, in Delhi, there is a time where they were drawing these, DMRC was drawing these metro lines, and they wanted properties for the place for making the stations. A lot of houses, like if you go to Kailash Colony, there are a lot of places where houses were taken over by them. So first there must be a need, a public need, an amenity, because of which the government is willing to acquire a property. So there'll be first notification in the papers, in the general gazette, that I want to acquire, this is the purpose, these are the areas. Then you will be called upon, a valid compensation will be paid to you, the compensation amount is then dependent, and only then can you acquire the property. So that acquisition process is quite different from a person entry simply to your house with a request that I want to connect your sewage disposal system to the main sewage line. Now that's a very different concept of providing services to the public at large. So that is why it is happening. And it's happened over across a lot of cities. In fact, I'm also essentially from a place, Udaipur. Now there, the government came up with a notification of making Udaipur a smart city. The first step they did was this only. They lay down a central pipeline, sewage pipeline, and they went to each and everybody's house and connected that pipeline to that meter. Because they wanted to, at the end of the day, wanted to control the disposal of the disposal. They wanted to manage the disposal of the waste. So, can anybody come to court? The answer is no.
Thank you so much, sir.
I hope, Arnab, this discourages the querist from approaching the court for such a thing. Indeed. I hope his query is satisfied that yes, the government does have some right to enter into property for your own good.
Well.
Yes, next question, please.
So, sir, our next question is also a theoretical question. Can a person file a petition under Order 9, Rule 9 for restoration of the suit after 1 year later due to ill health?
Now see, the answer to that question is a yes or a no, both. Now, once the suit gets dismissed in default or due to non-prosecution or when you don't appear before the then under Order 9, you can file an application for seeking restoration of the suit. And there are various principles that the courts have over the period of time laid down, which will govern this. Now, we will have to first explain the reasons for not knowing the dismissal of the suit. Now, it's a dual responsibility, right? It's the lawyer's responsibility, but primarily it's the client's responsibility to be aware of such a thing. There are times where the lawyer is asking for instruction, the client is not giving the instructions, the requisite instructions. And then there are times where the clients are willing to give the instructions, but there is an inability to do it on the basis of their health. So then you have to approach to the court and then explain and give out various reasons for the delay. If the health wasn't well, then this issue should be something which prevented you from doing any other thing. It can't be for the rest of the things I was able to do, but only for litigation, I will invoke this. So the courts are usually liberal, but then you do have to then explain, because the idea is that no party should be left remedyless. But at the same time, you cannot sleep over your right for some time and then approach the court and say, I'm sorry, I was not diligent enough. So the factors that you have to keep in mind is you have to show that the client was diligent. There were circumstances which prevented him from using or approaching the court, or these are the reasons because of which. So it is possible, but then it's a tough road where you have to explain the delay as well as to what were those prevailing circumstances which prevented you from approaching the court. So you can do it is the answer.
Moving on to the next question, sir. The querist had purchased a land in 2001. He then went abroad and entrusted his property to his brother, who without telling the querist, sold the land by making a false power of attorney. Now the person whom the land was sold to has built a house on that particular property. Is there any legal remedy in this regard?
Okay, again, this is somewhat similar to the earlier question that I answered. Now, see, there are again two, three different factors. If you have given, entrusted your property to your brother, is it by way of a document? Is there a relinquishment deed? Is there a power of attorney? We have to look at all of those things. In absence of any of these things, the brother has no right to sell a property. Like I again said, and I said earlier also, you do not have the right to sell which does not belong to you. You cannot have a better title on the property because I am the owner of the property. The brother cannot. Now, second part of the question that you say that there is a power of attorney, but there are, it appears to be forced. Now, then you have the remedy of forgery. You can file a criminal complaint against your brother, saying that you have sold off my property. You've, by virtue of fraud, there's a forgery on the document. These signatures are not mine. And then you'll have to prove those signatures, whether they are yours or not. There is forensic evidence, investigations are there, and so on and so forth. Now, the essential part of the question is, now once it is sold off, what do I do with the property? Then you can have a suit. You can have a suit for declaration saying that the power of attorney per se, one, is illegal. Two, an injunction against the person from then selling it off and alienating the property and taking the possession from the third person. So there are multifaceted reliefs here. You will have to then first prove to the court, because see, you're saying that the power of attorney is forged, the court will not accept. Merely on the basis of a statement, you'll have to then prove. So the first action that he must take, steps that he must take is first file a complaint to the local police under the whose jurisdiction his house is, and then say that this is an act of forgery and fraud played by him. I never gave him the right. To then approach the court and seek a cancellation of that document and say that this document is forged and fabricated and therefore cannot be acted upon, and the, any effects that or any right that arose out of this should be void. Then you have to seek cancellation of the sale deed between your brother and the third party and then take back the possession. So this is the remedy. It's a huge process. It's a cumbersome process. It's a tough process. It is a time-consuming process and it will take its own time, because there are various factors that you have to prove here. You have to prove the fraud. You have to prove that how did you entrust the property? How did you have the right? And more essentially, what were you doing all these years? Because it's your property. So there are various host of factors that you must prove, take care of before you go.
So our next question is again related to the repayment of loan. Where a person has taken a loan from another and the agreement between them stated that the repayment of loan should happen within 11 months. But now the other person is asking for loan repayment within 2 months. Is there any remedy for the same?
So, see, there are different ways and there are various procedures that you can follow. Now, one being that you can file a complaint under the Indian Penal Code to the local police jurisdiction under Section 272, if I'm not wrong, where you can say that a person is selling adulterated food. Two, if you are the purchaser of such a food, then you can also file a complaint that somebody is selling adulterated food under the Consumer Code. But essentially, there is a Food Adulteration Act also, which has a detailed procedure prescribed in it. And it has its own mechanism, which can be invoked. This is called a Food Adulteration, Food Safety and Service Providing, if I'm correct, the name of that thing, where you can send in a complaint. You can send them a WhatsApp. You can send them an email. And there is a helpline number also available under the Food Safety and Security Code. So once you give them the complaint, then they will appoint a food inspector. And that food inspector under the Section 16, if I'm not wrong, will go and then inspect the premises and see whether there is an adulteration there or not. So you do have various remedies available under different statutes where you can approach these authorities and agencies. These are quick. Your time is not then utilized because you are the only person who's complaining to the society and saying that, please go and inspect the premises. I believe there is some adulteration going on. So these are the various processes. Yes, are rice mills covered under it? The answer to that is also yes, that yes. Even rice mills and rice selling of rice is also covered under the Adulteration Act.
Thank you, sir. With that, we'll be moving to our last question of the session. Now, a querist has asked if she can file a case of public nuisance or any other legal claim upon a family living in a society for dumping the garbage out of their house They do it just outside other people's house. So, also, they burn the garbage at sometimes that results into pollution. What is the possible remedy here?
Now, again, even in this, there are different procedures. You will see, like in Delhi, burning of garbage is banned. And then there is a pollution control board, PSSB or PCCB, if I'm not wrong, where you can file a complaint that somebody is burning the garbage outside, because then it's essentially a case of a pollution. Then you can also file a complaint in the local police station saying that they are dumping and causing nuisance and the garbage is being thrown out of my house and they are burning it up. You can also file a complaint in the municipality or the municipal corporation, bringing to their notice that a particular act of such a kind of an act is being carried out outside. So yes, these are the various remedies that are available to you to protect and prevent somebody from doing all of these things. So you can invoke any of these three procedures.
With that, sir, we come to our end of the session. Thank you very much for taking out a valuable time and joining this particular session, this quick reply response session. With that, I would like to wrap this particular session for today. Any last message from your side would be highly appreciated, sir.
First of all, I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity to answer all these questions, and whatever knowledge I have, I hope I was able to satisfy the queries to the best of my capabilities, and I was able to answer them as honestly as possible and as much as I could. I'm not going to claim that I am obviously 100% correct on everything that I say. There are different minds and different people, and the way they approach the subject is always different. And that's why we have multiple lawyers in the city. Everybody will have their own take on it. I will like to wish everybody that please stay inside, please stay safe. And in case there are any queries that you have, you can always approach Lawyers Club India and then put in their firms, and people like me are always willing to help you out. And I hope all those people whose questions that you've selected, they found the relief that they were looking for. I'm happy to be back whenever you say. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
So much, sir.
Well, that's all for today. I hope you must have learned as much as I did on this side of the camera. Do stay tuned for more sessions like this. And don't forget to post your queries on Lawyers Club India now. Thank you. This is Arnab Rajan, content writer, Lawyers Club India, signing off. We'll be right back.